And we're live. Testing, testing. Just making sure the volume's good. Testing. Just checking the stream quality here on my laptop. All right, yeah. Everything looks to be in readiness. Okay. Oh, I just realized I can't tell how many people are in the chat here. The eternal question of wait for more people to show up or just get started. Hello, hello. Welcome. Gonna get started real soon here. Cool. All right. I'm gonna stop looking at that stream. Didn't want to deafen y'all with clearing the throat. Hi, welcome everybody. Today I am going to be playing Nosu. Nosu. I realize I don't actually know how to pronounce that. Which is a game by Jonathan Whiting. As you can see, jonathanwhiting.com/game/Nosu. Jonathan has done several games in the past, like cool stuff on his website. And it's available for all the main PC operating systems. And yeah, let's not look at the screenshots here, but its page describes it as a non-Euclidean horror game, and he gives a shout out to me in the history here, which is awesome. He's alluding to my tourism thing, which if you've seen me stream before, that is a thing that I do. I remove combat from games and stream it, or just wander around the levels and be a tourist. So anyway, let's jump right in here. Okay, yeah. And there is in-game audio playing. There's the music. I'm almost a little worried about it not being loud enough, maybe. It comes in quietly. Okay. All right, so this is a first-person game. I should say up front, I have played this before. I played through it once, the day it was released, and yeah. So I do know what's coming, but I don't feel like it's a game where necessarily that's what everything depends on. So, and just one quick comment I wanted to make. I really love the font here. Like, it's high enough resolution to have like some real style as a pixel font, and just kind of sets the tone. But yeah, we are in a first-person abstract world of shimmering pixels. The game is like rendering at even over and above just the resolution of the textures which you can see when you walk up close to them. This game is running at a fixed or an intentionally low resolution, and it produces like this kind of it produces this kind of boiling effect, which by virtue of the choice of resolution, is very clearly intentional. I think, yeah, like this pattern that you can see. I mean, you see this a lot on digital displays, like the way that this pattern like kind of coalesces into these streaks. It's called the moire, or maybe I'm not pronouncing that effect that correctly. Moire or moiré or something else. Anyway, there's this artifacting that goes on when you have like a something like a regular grid, and it's being sampled at a low enough resolution, and it just kind of boils. And I think I don't think this is the first game that I've ever seen that takes advantage of that, that like wields that effect as part of its aesthetic intentionally. But it's certainly, you know, it's certainly not a super common thing. So yeah, we're in a first-person environment here, and I know just from having seen a little bit of this game come along is that it is the author's custom Ray Tracer Doom-style engine. And you can, one of the interesting artifacts about it, you can see it more easily when there's a low ceiling, is that the ground distorts as I look down. The ground kind of distorts in a way that is very reminiscent of Doom and games of its eras like Software Renderer. So like it doesn't quite, like if this were, you know, just rendering in a full 3D OpenGL world with, you know, where you could just look directly down and stuff, but you can't, and that's by virtue of the fact that I don't really know any of the deep details about how this game's engine works, but it is definitely like kind of Doom Software rendering. So let's carry on here. Unlike Doom, it has, you know, these kind of smooth, curvy walls that appear to be kind of parametric. And also, unlike Doom, it is a portal-style renderer, and we'll soon discover what that actually means to the game. So yeah, we explore a little further here. We're seeing the same kind of color palette. The floor is now got that busy noir pattern. And as we walk around here, we see... Oh, wait a minute. We see that... Oh, darn it. Sorry, my laptop that I'm using to monitor the chat went to sleep. Sorry, I've got to tell it to... I should really install caffeine on here. Keeps it awake. Okay, anyway. Right as we were getting to the good bit. So yeah, like, we can see that space has... That things... This level looks one way when we're standing in one place, and quite a different way. And this is where the non-Euclidean aspect of the game comes in. So we walked into that, and we, like, it. There was that white cylinder that was playing that kind of intense noise, and we walked into it, and the first time I played this, I was kind of expecting to be teleported. But no, it merely dematerialized that shape. And when we're standing near it, it puts this cool, like, kind of vertical color striping effect on the screen. And it's, like, really... beautiful and just kind of creates an interesting visual effect. It reminds me a little bit of the slit scan sequence from 2001. So okay, we're not really sure what that did, except for the fact that now we're actually in a different place and we're looking down on this area where we were before. We've got these two new doorways that we can go to. Let me check the chat here. Claire asks, what does it mean that it's ray tracing? Doesn't everything ray trace? Yeah, like the use of ray tracing to mean... ray tracing can mean several different things. Because, yeah, like... I mean, technically they're all emulating what ray tracing does. Ray tracing is... in computers, when you simulate the path of light from to the eyeball, you know, so yeah, so you say, okay, well, there's a putative light source that is casting rays of light at a surface, and then it's bouncing off of that surface to us. Anytime you're kind of simulating that in one way or another, and there's a bunch of different ways to do it, there's a bunch of different, like, depths to which you can do that. Like, there were early, like in the 90s, there were like ray tracing, offline ray tracing renderers that you could use to like render like glass or chrome spheres on checkerboards, and you would see the refraction and stuff. That's kind of more low level. Like, it also, like, Raycaster is sort of what people used to refer to engines like Wolfenstein that rendered their admittedly way simpler worlds just by saying, like, okay, for every pixel in the screen, we should determine if there's a wall there and then draw the pixels on that wall and use like a fast texture lookup thing. There's kind of so many different ways to achieve that effect that it doesn't. And that's the other thing is that it doesn't end up translating to a lot of concrete stuff within the game's aesthetics, because like a modern version, a modern port for Doom is not doing anything that could remotely be described as ray tracing, but it still looks. You can still get a result that looks more or less identical to Wolfenstein 3D. So, I don't know. Yeah, I don't want to rattle too much on that, but yeah, it's just like at this point in indie games, it just kind of refers to a general generational look of 3D technology. So anyway, yeah, we're looking down on here, and if we pass through here, then we will pass through that point that is view center right there. And so there's one spot that we haven't really explored yet, which I think is this. Oh, but that's actually where we went before. So yeah, even here there's like a kind of interesting trickery happening, but it's relatively easy to digest because it's being done in a small enough space, which is cool. This is an area that has like a pretty different color feel, and there's like interesting sounds playing. And this we actually passed on the way in. We couldn't get up there. There's no jump in this game. So we passed through here on our way to that first anomaly. But yeah, so let's carry on here. Alright, and now we're actually overlooking the starting area. And we're like, okay, well, I think at this point we've explored all of the space, but in fact we haven't, because that was where we started, and now there's a portal into a new part of the level, and that white beam shot out in front of us and appears to have taken up residence here, which is really cool. The sort of low dread sound happening here is really awesome, and it definitely gives this game a similar kind of feel to another abstract first-person 3D world game called Cairo. And yeah, that's all I have to say about that for now. And yeah, these sounds seem like they're kind of localized, but because they're just like ambient, it just kind of reads as an ambient, you know, as the soundtrack mixing in and out spatially. Just catching up on the chat here. Cool. Okay, so yeah, now there are several new areas open up to us, and so let's just pick a direction here, honestly. Okay, so we're getting that sound again, which means that there's an objective nearby, but we're kind of gated off from that. So in that kind of artist statement on the game's page, oh goodness. So yeah, we appear to have been jumped by a rather scary thing here. Let me tab back out here, because I think what I would like to do is turn down the... Oh, I can't... Oh, well, there's probably an in-game. Yeah, there we go. All right, I'm going to turn down the volume just a little bit, because I think that sound gets a little overwhelming when it reaches its peak. Yeah, so we kind of fell into this weird traveling anomaly that really messes with how the world renders, and it's kind of the closest thing that feels like an enemy that we've encountered so far in this game. And yeah, I wanted to talk about that a little. You know, the author mentions that he was inspired by, in part, by the tourism stuff that I had been doing, and, there is kind of a question in this that I think that this game clearly seems to be trying to address, which is, if you take combat out of a game, out of a first-person game, especially one that feels a little bit like a weird version of Doom, like, what do you have left? And I think that's potentially, like, a really grand question, you know? Um, And in some ways, you're just kind of asking a negation. You're like, well, if not X, then everything but X. And so this game is just kind of trying to provide one answer, I think. But in that case, like, what that thing, you know, that thing is, like, sort of threatening and overwhelming, even though it's not, like, killing you or there's no concept of damage, but it still just does kind of feel like it's threatening this sense of safety you have as a player. And so it's like, okay, well, yeah, you want to avoid that thing. And there's not even any stealth to it, so it's not like a lot of avoidance games. But yeah, it's doing something with that. And yeah, I think it's a good element. I think, you know, the time and manner in which it's introduced and the semi-dynamic or random way that it works is cool. It gives you something else to think about that I think is pretty congruent with exploring this weird space and being kind of put off by... Yeah, this is interesting. So compared to, like, when you start off, the screen isn't swimming like this. I'm not actually sure what's making it do it, but you'll see this kind of shimmering, and I'm sure the compression on the stream is butchering it to an extent. But the way that these pixels are kind of swimming around, this is another, like, really intentionally wielded, interesting effect, I think. Yeah, see, I think that thing is coming for us. And yeah, that time I just sort of let it get us. It feels like one of the things that it feels most analogous to is the creature, whatever you call it, Rover from The Prisoner, like the original, like the old Patrick McGoohan TV show. Because it's this very abstract thing, but it's clearly malicious. And the fact that it's abstract actually adds a lot to its threatening, to its ability to be threatening. So yeah, that's kind of what I'm going to call the cloud of static that travels this world. And I think it moves semi-dynamically. Oh gosh. Yeah, and it feels very scary when you try to... Oh god! Well, that time I was just completely taken by surprise by it. Yeah, you can see that it has a kind of cylindrical footprint, sort of. Anyway, I should actually try to progress through here. There's also one more thing about, like, sort of the visual tech of this game, and yeah, you almost certainly won't be able to see this on the stream, is each individual pixel is getting kind of, like, perturbed. I don't know, like, because it's clearly, it's running at a higher native resolution. Like, it looks like it's running at 1080p on my monitor, but there's just, like, individual pixels that a given texture pixel is getting kind of chunked up into, which reminds me a little bit of, like, the sort of software of the Unreal 1 software renderers sort of equivalent of bilinear resampling. And if y'all watched my Unreal Tourism stream, you saw me kind of nerd out about that a little bit. It's just an interesting effect that makes a lot more sense on a CPU than it does, you know, on a GPU. Although I'm assuming that this is being done with a shader or something. Anyway, okay, so that's, yeah, so this is, we're back at the hub here. And yeah, like, it's definitely a very interesting process, and this is something that I fear I might be spoiling for y'all by playing through this, by denying y'all the pleasure of navigating this space for yourself under your own choices. Is that, you know, usually when you play a first person, any game with any kind of 3D space, oh gosh. You're building a mental map, and the way that knowing that this space is non-Euclidean, i.e. it doesn't knit together in the way that a conventional space where if you walk in the same direction forever, you won't pass the same place, it does something kind of interesting to your brain. It's sort of like your brain is creating a pretzel of a map rather than a map that... Oh, God! a map that we can understand using kind of conventional spatial terms. And you end up moving in these loops. You kind of have to discover a lot of these recursions. Oh gosh, it's on to me. And yeah, you kind of have to discover a lot of these recursions just by moving in the same loop. And then you realize that you've doubled back. Okay, yeah, and that's actually where we came from. And the process of puzzling that out while staying clear of the rover is really like kind of the fundamental challenge of this game. And I think it's really interesting. You know, visually, this game does so much more of its... This game does so much more of its heavy lifting with color compared to most games. And I think it's able to do that because it's abstract. Sort of an interesting lighting effect happening on the ceiling there. All right. Okay, we've doubled back again. Aha, there we go. Goodness. So yeah, that's another one of those weird glowy beams claimed. Now I kind of just want to find the way back home. But perhaps instead we will get devoured by the weird anomaly. The rover. Okay, so yes, I think this is, yeah, this is, so yeah, we've now claimed that white cylinder thingy. And now we're back out here. And rover is really interrupting our ability to appreciate having claimed the second thingy. Okay, so now we're in sort of a gray type area. This texture, by the way, is very reminiscent of one of the base textures from Quake 1. It feels definitely like an intentional mod. I'm going to assume it is. There's like a, it's a different color sort of thing, but it's this texture, if you've played Quake 1, like the base levels that are at the first level of every episode, it's definitely, it's, yeah, that shape is kind of unmistakable. So now we're in like this gray kind of area. Oh gosh! And there comes Rover after us. And there's a bunch of interesting shapes around here. Oh goodness. And we've kind of doubled back yet again. The author explained briefly how the editor for this game works to me. And it's pretty cool. Like, it's clearly got, like, kind of, there's a curve piece, and you can set different sector heights and such. Oh gosh, are there multiple ones of these? I think there's multiple rovers. That can't be good. Multiple rovers is bad. Oh-ho. It's one of the thingies. So let's see if we can successfully claim this without getting devoured. Alright, so we've got like this kind of spiral upward feature to walk up. Alright, I think we've got it. No, don't devour us. There we go. Well done. Yeah, I think there are just like... Yeah. Yeah, that sound that we're hearing right now, it feels like it's coming from that teal colored light source. And that's a really interesting idea, is like having, you know, usually in video games, you like in realistic environments or whatever, you want to have, you know, if there's an unmotivated sound effect, like you're hearing like some ambience and you can, and particularly if it's spatialized, but you don't know what it is, like where it's coming from, then that's not a good thing. You're just like, where the heck is that bird chirping coming from? Or is this, are there invisible birds or whatever? Whereas here, it's just like, okay, this is an abstract world, and a sound can come from just like an invisible light source or a blob of color. And I think that's really interesting, you know? I think that's just kind of wielding some of these abstract level design tools, you know, in an interesting kind of way. The whole, the rainbow spectrum noise kind of thing that's happening, I don't actually know what, like, it might just be pulsing, you know, in and out over the course of, like, 5 seconds or so. That might be what's happening here. Yeah, I was kind of taking it as, like, a feedback element about something else, but I don't know if it is. Catching up on the chat here. Yeah, someone asks, is there a black rover and a yellow rover? And I don't really know. I mean, they all kind of look the same to me, but maybe there's like a nuance of the visuals that I'm not getting. Okay, so there's a nice elegant visual language for like how far into this particular objective we are, because there's like these four platformy or pedestal teleport pad thingies, and there's only one of them free, so we know that, you know, we're probably like 3/4 of the way through this game's objectives. Okay, so I think the pink, forget if we've been here before. I think we have. I think this is where, well, maybe not actually. Yeah. That's another like gradually moving pool of color, I guess. Oh ho, here we go. Alright, that one was comparatively easy. But yeah, like in my first playthrough, I was like stumbling around a whole bunch, you know, in this area, just because there are some, you know, there's like, oh, check it out, there's, you know, behind this pillar here, there's this curved thing which leads you back into here. Ugh! Back here, and I think this is the way back. It looks like the way that we came in, though. Okay, yeah, here we go. And yeah, I think that is it. Now we're getting sucked into the center. Kind of reminds me of a more psychedelic, disturbing version of the Seasons Changes in Proteus, where, well, I don't want to spoil it. Like, you should play Proteus, because it's kind of one of the early tourism-focused games with chunky pixels, but it's beautiful. And I think that is it. Yeah, we are at the end here. It's possible. I didn't try playing this twice in the same session, so maybe there's something. Maybe there's a new game plus or an additional challenge. Probably not, though. So, yeah, but I think that is about it. And yeah, that is Nosu, or Nosu. Perhaps the author can clarify its pronunciation, or maybe it's written down somewhere and I just didn't catch it. But yeah, let's quit out of here. So yeah, that is that short little game, and I thought it was really cool. I think, you know, it definitely fulfilled the implicit question of tourism, which is, if you take like combat like conflict out of a 3D space exploration game, what do you have left? And I think, you know, like, yeah, that's a really good answer. You know, there's like something that you're kind of afraid of that's just sort of like weird aesthetically, And also you're trying to explore every reach of the environment and find these little kind of flags that have been planted. Anyway, that's really like kind of putting a little bow on it, and I think the value of this kind of game is that you can't put a little bow on it, no matter what some, you know, smart aleck on Twitch says about the game. But yeah, I think that's probably about all I've got. Yeah, you can get this game on the author's website, jonathanwhitting.com. And yeah, check out some of their other work, and yeah, I think that's about all I've got. But yeah, thank you very much for watching me play this, and I hope to do some more tourism-type streams in the future. Maybe I'll play some Thief or some Quake 1 or something like that. But yeah, thank you very much for watching, and thank you, Jonathan Whitting, for making this game and for giving me a shout-out in the blurb for it. And yeah, have a good one. Thanks for watching.